Hi, we run that session called Accessibility, What You Need to Know as a Designer on Wednesday, the 1st of September, but we didn't record the event. I'm Stephanie, and this video is for people who could not attend and just for the part I was presenting. On the day, we also had Lizzie covering the content part and Neil covering testing. We are sharing the slide, and you will find some links in there with some more resources for each section. So feel free to use the slides, copy them, change them, make your own presentation, spread the knowledge, and also tell us if something is not right or not clear so we can improve. So in this video, I will cover what is accessibility, permanent, temporary, situational disability. Also, I'll try to make the terminology a bit less confusing. I'll talk a little about assistive technologies, about colors, image, and other media. I'll give you some general recommendation, and I'll tell you a bit more about what I call the wow factor. We did not talk about WCAG, which stands for Web Content Accessibility Guideline, because it's not the most engaging way to talk about accessibility. WCAG is about compliance, and compliance is not enough. So instead, we are giving a few things to think about, which hopefully will make sense to you and which will be easy to apply in lots of situations. So, what is accessibility? In the UK, 1 in 5 people are disabled. It can affect their vision, their hearing, their speech. It can be a physical disability or it can be a cognitive disability. This means it affects their memory or how they process things and think. Or it can be a mix of them. In fact, it's quite frequent that people have more than one disability. And it's not always visible to others. This is important too, because we often make assumptions regarding the ability of a person and we can get it wrong both ways. So, for example, we might underestimate what a visibly disabled person can do, or we might assume someone can do something or is okay because they look okay, whatever okay or normal is. So, accessibility means that you don't put barriers for them to access the same thing as the others. And whether it's online, in that case we talk about digital accessibility, or in a digital space, or when they use a device or an object. Permanent, temporary, situational disability. You might have already seen that diagram, it's used a lot in lots of presentation. Quite often, when we speak about disability, we think of permanent and visible disability. But you can be injured and be temporarily affected the same way as a person who's permanently disabled, or you can be in a situation that makes you experience a similar issue. This diagram from Microsoft is a very good illustration of this and show you permanent, temporary, and situational situation, not sure about that, for touch, see, hear, and speak. And you'll find the link in the resources. If you click on that link, it downloads the whole toolkit. So, for example, part of this, if we focus on speak, a person can be permanently non-verbal for various reasons. And this will be a barrier when you use a voice recognition system like Alexa, for example. But you might be affected just the same if you have a laryngitis. That would be temporary. And this is also something that someone with a strong accent, like me, could struggle with. It can and it will affect everyone at some point in life. So, with COVID and working from home, a lot of people have been like this person in the photo on the slide, taking care of their toddler while working. And yeah, people might be multitasking, tired, or in a noisy environment, or taking care of children or pets on their phone and on the move instead of sitting at a desk on their laptop, and accessibility will help them too. So I want to clarify a few terms, as people are often confusing accessibility with other things which might exclude people. So one important thing to consider, intersectionality is important to understand because we tend to put people in categories clearly defined with one characteristic, but the reality is much more complex than that. And other things like your gender, your LGBTQ status, or poverty will also impact your digital experience when you're disabled. Disabled people might lack the money, for example, to buy new devices, or not have the energy or ability to focus on your digital service or product. Accessibility is also different from assisted digital support. If you don't work for the government, you might have never heard about this term, but that covers the fact that some users might need support because they don't have digital skills or they have no internet access or a poor connection or not enough data. They might be using an old device or they don't trust your service or internet in general. They might fear for their safety. That's quite common, for example, in victim of domestic abuse. Or they have a lack of confidence to use an online service themselves. In this situation, the solution is often a phone call or acting on their behalf or guiding them over the phone. So, on top of all the previous reason where people might struggle online, you should avoid creating more reason for people not to use your service online. If your online service is not accessible, you might have to offer some assisted digital support. And yeah, at this point, even though it's not about accessibility, it might be worth mentioning digital inclusion because a lot of designers don't realize this. So, for example, that's from a survey, that's the source in the slide. 2 in 10 adults lack basic digital skills. So, things like finding info online, shop online, filling a form. 1 in 10 have no digital skills. 13% of households have no internet access at home. And 1 in 8 adults do not use the internet at all. So keep in mind that these statistics were pre-COVID, and a big effort has been made to provide devices, data, and training with the Connecting Scotland program, for example. So it's probably better now, but it's still very important to keep in mind. Another term that is quite often misunderstood as well is inclusion. This is wider than accessibility. So on this slide, the big circle for diversity and inclusion has lots of different parts in it. Accessibility is only one of them. So it's disability on the yellow circle at the top. But there are other things to consider to be inclusive. So things like age, ethnicity, body size, gender and sexuality, education, culture and customs, diet, way to communicate, income and social class. And yeah, there's more very, if you look online, there's more complex diagram addressing other parts to keep in mind to be inclusive. But that's a good summary. Yeah, so common inclusion issues are, for example, asking for your gender in a way that doesn't allow you to identify yourself correctly. And quite often, you even wonder why they need your gender in the first place. It could be parent information in terms which excludes same-sex parenting, or it could be providing a set of instructions only working for right-handed people, or only considering white people when testing your product. So for things like plasters or makeup, and I don't know if you've seen that online, but the racist soap dispenser, because it was only working if you had white skin. And things like seats, clothes, security center that won't fit petite or plus size people. So all these things are really important and you should aim at being inclusive. But today we are only going to focus on one part of this, which is accessibility. So to summarize, if you're not accessible, you're not inclusive of disabled people. If you are accessible, but you offer no alternative for people who need digital support, you are not inclusive either. Okay, so now that I've explained a bit more what I mean by accessibility, I'm going to put a bit more light on something that is often overlooked, which is the assistive technologies. So quite often, designer works on good websites, they have big screens and have the latest mobiles to check the app or website they're working on. But people might be using your website or your product in a way you never planned for. And it's okay, even if you test thoroughly, you can't plan for everything, but you should know of some common assistive technologies. And also, usually when we talk about assistive technology, we think of a blind person with no vision at all, expert at using their screen reader, because it's the people we see in the video on YouTube or those who come to accessibility testing session, if you've been to some of these. But there is a much wider range of assistive technologies, and people vary also in their ability to use them. So people might be using websites in a way you did not expect. A dyslexic person might be using a screen reader, even though they can see. Someone with a motor impairment might be using a switch or their voice to interact instead of a keyboard or a mouse. And a person with low vision might be zooming to see or use a large mouse pointer. So on this slide, we have some photos with a few examples. So we have a person using a mouse stick to use a keyboard. A man holding a switch with a tool. So it's a tool to help navigate a website or an app. We have someone using a braille keyboard. And a keyboard for people with low vision. That's the keyboard with the very bright yellow keys with big characters in black on it. So this slide is accessible only for screen reader user. I've shared a link to the slide so you can check for yourself if you want. But there is text on this slide. Someone using a screen reader would hear the text, which you can't see unless you select it manually with your mouse. If you are using a screen reader because you can't see, you don't know there's a problem. And usually it's the other way around. But if you are using a screen reader, even though you can see, then you would wonder where the text you hear is coming from. So be careful when you start adding text only for screen readers users. It's usually not a really good idea. I mean, some occasion it makes sense, but be careful with that. You should aim at providing the same information to everyone, whether they can see or not, whether they can hear or not. And one thing I see a lot these days is providing a caption to describe an image as well as an alt text saying the same thing. So it's probably for a good attention, but a screen reader, you would hear the information twice and that's annoying. So you can still have both a caption and an alt text, but they must complete each other and provide the same information for a person who can't see. Not more, not less. It's not easy to do, but that's the aim. So the previous slide is something I saw in a presentation to explain accessibility barriers the other way around, but it's something that can happen on a website, especially in dark footers or headers. So you might think that the search box is not working in the example you see on screen. So it's a footer, it's a dark footer, and the text in the footer is white, but there's also a white background input search box and the text is still white, so you have white on white and you can't see unless you select it. So if you don't realize that, you might be typing thinking what you're typing is not working. So be careful with that as well. So that's a very, very quick tour, but if you want to learn more about assistive technologies, we have some more links to resources in the slides we have shared. Okay, so what happens when you can't use a mouse? But you can try yourself. So to do that, don't use your mouse and instead use the tab key to move forward, shift and tab key to move backward. And if you're not too sure about what the keys look like, that's how they look most of the time on keyboards. Can you still navigate and use the website? So try to do that if you're working on a website. And also, when you need to zoom to see, some people need to zoom a lot to see. So try yourself. To zoom, you can either use the setting of your browser or use the Control and Plus key to zoom in and Control and Minus key to zoom out. So on screen, you see how it looks like for if you zoom 400% on LinkedIn. And you can try doing that and navigate yourself on LinkedIn, and good luck with that. So if you create website, always do at least these two tests. Test with keyboard only and zoom at 400%. This will help you to pick up some issue. So get in the habit of doing that each time you develop something, but also make sure to test with disabled people because they will find even more issues. And just to be clear as well, these two tests are only for you to find issues because to understand how it is to rely on zooming to use a website, for example, that's not the, it's not for you to try 10 minutes, but to speak with someone who experienced this every day. That's how you learn how it can be, how difficult it can be, what's the real issue. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about colors. So you might know about all that, but maybe you'll still learn something. They're not always yours to choose because you might rely on an existing brand. In that case, you might still need to make some slight change to make them accessible. So make sure your contrasts are good. There are plenty of tools to do that, and we have some links for you in the resources that we will share. On the slide, you can see something with poor contrast, which is hard to read. And think about that for text, but also buttons, links, icon, navigation item, and also don't forget the hover states of your links or buttons and visited links as well. And don't rely on color only. So you might have seen this image on social media. So it's three boxes, one with green elastic band that says you're okay with hugs, another one with yellow elastic band that says you're okay with talking but not touching, and the third box is when you'd rather keep your distance. So all that looks like a good idea, but if you're colorblind, it's gonna look like that. So much harder to make the difference. So in that scenario on elastic band, it's probably not much you can do. Elastic is not super easy to customize. But if you're using a lanyard, you might be able to use add some texture like add stripes or dots, for example. So use a pattern so it's not just color. And in the digital world, it's important for your error messages, but also for your buttons and the color of your links and icons. There are some simulators for color blindness, but you should not base your color choice on them. Just assume some people don't see colors at all and have another way to convey any information with an alternative. So use color, but also make sure you have an alternative for people to realize what you mean if they don't see colors. Yeah, and that's another thing. Some people change your colors. If you want to know more about this, there's a very good presentation in the resources that we are sharing. There's a link to it. And this slide is based on that presentation. This is six screenshots of the same GovUK page using six different alternative colors options. Some browsers let you do that, and people do it for various reasons. And we should not interfere with this. Some need higher contrast, others need lower ones. Some prefer dark mode, others don't like them. So, yeah, that's one thing people always think, oh, what's the one solution? There's no perfect solution because user needs vary widely across people who have low vision, and one user needs may conflict with another user needs. That's a quote from the presentation I was talking. And one example, for example, is the need of the dyslexic people versus people with low vision. So on this slide, on the left, you can see a pale cream background and dark blue text. And that seems to be something which helps some dyslexic people, but not all of them. And font spacing is important for them as well. And on the right, what you see is a high contrast, which is better for some people with low vision. But then you also have dyslexic people who have low vision. So it depends. There isn't one perfect solution. You should offer alternative. And about dark mode as well. A lot of people are using dark mode for their browser or mobile, so make sure your image still works with this. I use dark mode, and a lot of dark transparent image or icon don't work well on dark mode because you can hardly see them. So be careful with that as well. It's something people often forget to test. Images and other media, so another important subject. Alt text, I've been mentioning it before already. Alt text is short for alternative text, and that's a text that is read by a screen reader when you are using an image. You might also see it and read it on screen if your image doesn't load or if there's a broken link. You need to provide that text to describe your image. So, for example, for this image, it could be two cute kittens in a paper bag. And this is an example of an alt text for this image, but depending on the context, you might write something different. A good way to know what to say for your alt text is to think of how you would describe it to someone over the phone. And it's best to keep it short and to keep to the level of detail needed to make your point. And if your image is only decorative, then your alt text should be an empty string. But you might want to rethink if you really need an image in the first place in that case. And while I'm talking about image, don't put text over an image unless the text is very clearly readable with some background, like on screen at the moment. So you have some dark green background behind the text instead of just writing white text on that image, which would have made it quite hard for you to read. Many websites still do that, and you might be requested to do that. You need to challenge it. Also, avoid photos of text. It's harder to read for everyone, and it's even worse when you zoom because it becomes pixelated. So, yeah, lots of things about images. And regarding alt text, there is a lot to think about that. And when you start trying to think about what you're going to put on your image, you might rethink which image you're using. So it's actually quite good because it forces you to consider what you're doing. So do try to get in the habit to always put your alt text and make sure you get it right as well. Captions, so that's for videos. Make sure people can understand your video even if they can't hear by adding caption. And if there's no sound, say it, because people who can't hear don't think they're missing out in that case. Auto-generated caption, so it's better than nothing, but it's really not ideal. Quite often there's lots of mistake in it. It's getting better, but still not right. If you can, provide a transcript for your videos and podcast. This will be handy for many people, but it's also the way to allow deafblind people to access your content. Social media. Describe your image. So we've talked about that already, but that's super important in social media because people use images to attract attention, but then they often don't use an alt text. People with using screen reader don't miss information if you put an alt text. And in some social media, you can't add a proper alt text. Those are getting better and better, but things like Yammer, for example, doesn't allow you to do that easily. So in that case, just describe it within your post in square brackets. Capitalize hashtag on social media. So yeah, this hashtag on screen is hard to read. This one is easier to read because I've put a capital at the start of each word in that hashtag. If it's not easier for you, well, if you use a screen reader, it's definitely easier because the screen reader will say the word separately in that case because the first letter is capital, is in capital. So this is how to format an accessible hashtag with a capital letter at the start of each word. That's how it look. So I don't know if you know this hashtag. It's A11Y and it's used on social media a lot, at least in what I use. It's a short version of the word accessibility. You take the first and last letters, and instead of writing the 11 letters in between, you just write 11. It's called a neuronym. Yeah, so another thing to do is avoid too many emojis and cute text. So in the slide, you'll find a link to that cute text example. The author made it on purpose so you can hear how bad it is. You can hear how it is for a screen reader. And basically, you hear letter by letter in that case. And it says something like add mathematical plus something depending on the font each time for each letter. I don't think I've listened to the recording at the end because it's very, very, very annoying. And also, yeah, emojis. You can use emojis, but avoid using too many of them because, for example, the one you have on screen at the moment, you would hear smiley face emoji. So if you put three of them, you're gonna hear that three time. So use them, but not too many of them. Some more general recommendation. So I keep saying that, but it's super important. There is no perfect solution which works for everyone. So don't look for it. Always plan for alternative and ask people what they need. Do not assume what they need. And try to find allies. So advocating for accessibility can be draining. Trying to find others in your team to help. Join groups and meetups. And on this slide, I've put UX designer in the middle because you are the target audience. We're called UX Glasgow, but this could be interaction designer or another title. Okay, so you're the designer, you've been working on your design, and you have accessibility in mind. A natural ally will be the content designer, copywriter, whatever their name is. And in my experience, it will be easy to get them on board because they are, if they are not already, you have many goals in common with them. So now that your design is going to be implemented, you want to make sure it's coded in a way that keeps it accessible. So make sure you're on the same page with your developer. And even more important, if this role exists, the tester. They are the one who will ultimately see if the design works as intended. So talk to them, and with any luck, they will be keen about accessibility. But you also want to make sure that you've done the proper research ahead of your design. So the user research will also be key. Did you research with disabled people ahead of your design? Did the user researcher make it easy for them to get involved? And then, did you do some usability and accessibility testing all along? And if you remember, it's one in five disabled people on average, so this should be reflected in the people you test with, ideally. If your user researcher is also aware about accessibility, this will definitely help. And if you can, take the others along to this session and record them. Record the session, I mean. It's already a good way to push your point across. So if you can manage to get that, that's going to help you. Okay, so sometimes you don't have so many people in your team. It's just you or the only one designing a website using WordPress, for example. In that case, make sure you learn your stuff and test with disabled users. And also take the people who ask for this website or app with you to make sure they get it as well. So we had a part on the day about accessible content that was delivered by Lizzie. And then we talked about the wow factor. So I don't know if it's a real term, but that's how I call it. So it's the kind of website that a lot of designer and people see and say, wow, it's really good. But what they don't realize is that a lot of people actually can't use that website. So maybe not so good. So some examples, so I'm not going to demo that in that video, but you have the links to this website in the slides. So the first one has been on social media for very bad reason recently. So it's Design Economy, and that's been done by the Design Council. So you would think they know better. That website, someone probably thought it was like, wow, it's really good, very different the way you navigate it, but it's full of motion. You couldn't use it without the mouse. And there was so many other issues. There was no mobile version at the time. They're working on it to fix it, but they had lots and lots of backlash on Twitter and other social media. So yeah, not a good thing. The second one has been there for a lot of times, so I don't know if they're gonna change that at some point, but it's full of motion. So if you need a website to illustrate motion, this one is really good. So the digital office one, and there's also some contrast issues and other things. So have a look as well, if you want. The link is in the slides. And the third one is an interesting case. There's a lot of motion. You rely on the mouse to use the interface in a fun way. And I mean, it should interest you because it's about misconception on UX. It's like a game to see how much you know about that. So have a look, but keep in mind that website is not accessible for most people. And another interesting thing about this website is that if you test it with an automating testing tool like Lighthouse, I don't know if you can see on my image, but it gets 100% score. The last time I've tested it, it's like, yeah, you're 100% accessible if you use a checker tool. But that's a good way to realize that, okay, you might have a very good score and that's good, but it's not enough to test accessibility. Use this test tool as a way to find issues you can fix, but then also test with people. Because you might be missing obvious issue that now I hope you know your test without the mouse and all that, but lots of people don't realize that and just rely on the tester. So that's a very good illustration of that problem. So why motion is a problem? I hope by now you have to make sure you understand you should be able to use the website without the mouse, but motion is not a problem known that well. So motion on screen can make people physically sick, and for some, it's not so many of them, but more and more. With my role, we heard lots of people feeling quite unwell with the cursor moving, for example. So always warn ahead and have a mode with no motion. And also, you might have a setting, so people who suffer from that might have a setting in their browser to stop motion to make sure. So make sure the way you code your website is not interfering with that. So it's more an advice for developers, but it's super important not to override that setting. Another group of people who might struggle with motion is because it's people with cognitive impairment because it's distracting. So it might be problematic for them. And yeah, so I'm not going to cover that because on the day it was covered with Neil, but yeah, test, automatic test, but test with disabled people. So where to learn more? So if you are, there's lots of options. If you're on Twitter or LinkedIn, follow disabled people or accessibility advocate. That way you hear directly from them about things you might have never realized before. And that's what I've been doing basically for the last years, and I've learned so much that way. In fact, I think I've done these slides a while ago, and I kept changing them because I kept learning things. So I learn things every week about accessibility just by following others. Another good thing I can advise you to do is to subscribe to the Accessibility Weekly. It's a newsletter. That's the link in the slide again. It just curates lots of other articles or things happening on the internet, so it's a good way to have the information curated for you. Also, join accessibility meetups. Most of them are online at the moment. There's lots everywhere, so there's a link to different accessibility meetups and groups. Also, check this accessibility reading list. So it's a link to a Gov UK blog post with lots of resources in there to give you some pointers to where you might improve, find info. And also, there's a course on an introduction to digital accessibility. At the moment, it's free and still available. So have a look. And we have even more resources in the slides. So I hope this was useful. We're not perfect, and I'm sure there are lots of results which we could have added in that presentation. We have tried to make the slides accessible and the presentation too, but do tell us if we've got something wrong or if there's something we could have done better. That's the only way we can improve. It's a journey, and we can only do as well as we can with what we know at that point. And I really hope this will have helped you understand the subject a bit better and will motivate you to learn more. So that's me, and thank you very much for watching this video. Bye.